Section 2.3 is more graphs for quantitative data. Remember, quantitative data just means numerical data. In this section, we're going to learn how to construct stem and leaf plots, dot plots, and time series plots. We won't actually be constructing time series plots, we'll just be looking at how to read and interpret them. Objective 1 is to construct a stem and leaf plot. Stem and leaf plots are a simple way to display small data sets. The keyword here is small. They don't work well for large data sets. They can get to be quite cumbersome. In a stem and leaf plot, the rightmost digit is the leaf and the remaining digits form the stem. Consider the values 14.8 and 2739. In 14.8, the stem part of the data value would be the 14, and then the last digit would be the leaf. On stem and leaf plots, the last digit will always be your leaf. For the number 2739, the 273 would form the stem, and then the 9 would be the leaf. In this example, we're going to construct a stem and leaf plot. The following table presents the U.S. Census Bureau projection for the percentage of population age 65 and over for each state and the District of Columbia. Construct a stem and leaf plot. How we go about doing this is we look at the data values, and the first two digits here will be the stem, everything to the left of the decimal, and then the last digit would be the leaf. The way we start this is we look at the numbers and then find the 14 on our chart here, and then the next digit, the 1, would be our leaf. So we look at these numbers, and whatever number is to the left of the decimal would be the stem, the number to the right of the decimal would be the leaf. Over here I have listed all the different stems we're going to need, and how we begin is we just fill in the numbers from the leaves. So I'm going to do this going down the first column and then wrap around. So we have 14.1, 14.3, 14.4, 17.8, so I drop down to the 17, 12.0, 0 would be the leaf here, 14.9, 12.6, 13.7, 12.8, 13.8, 13.7, 12.4, 13.8, 14.1, 13.3, 14.3, 16.0, 8.1, 11.5, 14.1, 10.2, 12.4, 13.4, 15.6, 12.8, 13.9, 12.3, 14.1, 15.3, 13.0, 13.6, 10.5, 12.4, 13.5, 13.9, I need to scroll this over, 10.7, 11.5, 14.3, 12.7, 13.1, 12.2, 12.4, 15.0, 12.6, 13.6, 13.7, need more room here, 15.5, 14.6, 9.0, 12.2, 14.0, and that's it. Once you have all of the data in the right place as far as the stems and the leaves go, the next thing you want to do is arrange each one of these rows in numerical order from least to greatest. So for the 8, that's easy. We just have one number, so that would be 8.1, 9.0. And then the 2, 5, and 7 are already in order from largest to smallest. Actually, it's not necessary to put commas between these numbers because we're going to be, we know that each single digit counts as a leaf or an individual numerical value. So for 10, I would put 2, 5, 7. For 11, I leave that 5, 5. And then 12, I've got to arrange these numbers in order from least to greatest. So we've got a 0, and then 2 2s, and we have 1, 3. We have 1, 2, 3, 4 4s. 1, 2, 3, 4. And we don't have any 5s. We have 1, 2 6s, a 7, and 2 8s, it looks like. For 13, we do the same thing. We have 1, 0, 1, 1, no 2s, 1, 3, 1, 4, 1, 5, two sixes, 1, 2, 3 7s, 1, 2, looks like 2 8s and 2 9s. And then for the 14, I have a 0 and 1, 2, 3, 4 1s. No 2s, 1, 2, 3, 3s, 1, 4, no 5s, 1, 6, and 1, 9. For the 15s, we have 0, 3, 5, 6. For the 16s, we have a 0, and for the 17, we have 8. So this is what your final answer would look like right here. The stem and leaf plot takes all of the data values and you plot each individual data value's leaf, or their last digit, on the appropriate stem. And the reason we like this kind of distribution is because it preserves our actual data values while still allowing us to see the general shape of the distribution. And if you'll remember from last week, we said that if we have the symmetric bell shape right here, we called that shape a normal shape. So here are the steps for making a stem and leaf plot. You want to make a vertical list of all the stems in increasing order and then draw a vertical line to the right of this list. That's the part that I had preloaded for you. Then for each value in the data set, write the leaf next to its corresponding stem. And for each stem then, after we do that, like we did here on the first graph, we'll then arrange the leaves in order from smallest to largest. And this is called a stem and leaf plot. It's possible to have a back-to-back stem and leaf plot because when two data sets have values that are similar enough so that some of the same stems can be used, their shapes can be compared with a back-to-back stem and leaf plot. Consider the following course averages from an English class and a history class. The classes can be compared with back-to-back stem and leaf plots. So it looks like the lowest grade that we have in the English class is a 45, but on the history class the lowest grade would be a 59. And you see that the stem part here would be the tens unit on our test scores, and then the leaves would be the single numerical values that are over here off to the left and off to the right. Now, the reason we like stem and leaf plots is because not only can we tell the shape, but it also preserves the actual data values. So for example, just looking at this stem and leaf plot, I could list the test scores for the English class from lowest to highest. I would have a 45, a 57, a 62, a 66, oops, forgot the 68, a 69, and so forth and so on. For the history class, the lowest test score would be a 59, and then I would also have a score of 61, 67, then I jump down to 71, so forth and so on. And hopefully you can see the pattern of what it is that we're doing right there. And this would be a back-to-back stem and leaf plot. Objective 2 would be to construct dot plots. Dot plots are pretty similar to stem and leaf plots in that we use each individual data values to plot something on a grid, but instead of recording numerical data values, we just put a dot for each data value. Consider the number of children had by each of the presidents of the U.S. and their wives. This would be the dot plot for each of these data values. So this would be the presidents that had 0 children, 1 child, 2, 3, 4, so forth and so on. And we can see the general shape of this distribution. And what shape does this look like? Right, it's skewed right. Remember, to determine if the distribution is skewed left or right, the tail tells the tale. This tail is going off to the right, so we would say that this distribution is skewed right. A dot plot gives a good indication of where the values are concentrated and where the gaps are. For example, it's immediately apparent that the most frequent number of children is 2, as seen by this point in the graph right here. And only 4 presidents had more than 6 kids. So here's the cutoff for the 6 kids, and we can see that these 4 numbers are greater than 6. The third objective, and the final objective for this section, is to construct time series plots. On your homework and on your test, I won't have you actually construct the plot, I'll just have you read them. A time series plot may be used when data consists of values of a variable that's measured at different points in time. In a time series plot, the horizontal axis presents time and the vertical axis represents the value of the variables that we're measuring. The following table and time series plot display the closing value of the Dow Jones Industrial Average at the end of each year from 2000 to 2012. Here's the table of data that has the years corresponding to the Dow Jones Industrial Average, and then we plot this over time. This scale right here on the vertical axis tells us that we're looking at the Dow Jones Industrial Average measured in dollars. So we start our scale at 0 and then go increase this at increments of 2000. So in 2000, the actual Dow Jones Industrial Average was $10,786.85, so we kind of eyeball where that is, and that's how we would plot these values, as we would treat these as if they were ordered pairs, X, Y, and then plot them along this grid. To see if you understand what I mean by reading the graph, without looking at this table here, can you tell me what the Dow Jones Industrial Average was about in 2002? Well, what we would do is we would go over here to year 2002, and then we would trace that up to see what that point was that corresponded to it, and we can see that it's really close to 8,000, just a little bit over. And then we can verify that by looking at the table and see that, yes, indeed, in 2002, the Dow Jones Industrial Average was $8,341.63. This is useful if you want to be looking at how data changes over time. Notice the big drop right here in 2008. That's because that's when Lehman Brothers went bankrupt and went into crisis, and it threw us into a recession right here in 2008. And you can see this drastic drop in the Dow Jones Industrial Average. Here's the steps for constructing a time series plot on your graphing calculator, but like I said, I'm not going to require you guys to do this on your calculator. If you want to read over this, you can. Basically, you're just using your graph plot again, and we'll be using the time series plot as the second graph, but you would have to put your data into two lists in your calculator. The first list would be the year, the second list would be your data values, and then go through and make sure that you have that second graph selected on your calculator, and then do zoom 9 and your calculator will give you the following graph. At the end of this section, you should know how to construct and interpret stem and leaf plots, dot plots, and time series plots. And this wraps up section 2.3.